South Africa is one of the oldest inhabited areas on Earth by hominids, meaning primates such as ourselves, who move habitually on two legs. More than 3 million years before humans entered North America, and more than 1.5 million years before human forerunners set foot in Asia and Europe, they were present in South Africa. Yet, as humans spread over the earth, major change came much later to South Africa than to other parts of Africa and the world. 70 centuries after cultivation of plants and a settled way of life had begun in Northeast Africa, it began in South Africa. Empires formed in West Africa more than 1,000 years before any large kingdom was established in South Africa. But when change came, it came repeatedly and rapidly. Many small African societies living under their own laws were consolidated by force within a generation during the early 19th century into a single military despotism, one of the most fully totalitarian societies ever described. A land that had always been a place of final settlement of slowly migrating families from the north, and was the recipient of languages, customs, and techniques that had been born, developed, and adopted elsewhere in Africa, suddenly became a trigger, dispatching waves of armed men on trajectories bringing sudden change to areas as far north as the shores of Lake Victoria, 2,000 miles away. A land which Europeans bypassed as worthless for 166 years after they had entered into trading relationships with West and East Africans, it became the first site of extensive European colonization on the continent. After its settlement by Europeans, for the next 200 years, it remained a rural backwater of the world economy. Then, at the end of the 19th century, in a period of 20 years, it burgeoned into the most industrialized society in Africa and gave rise to the largest city south of the Sahara. A land where for thousands of years egalitarian relationships had been practiced, it became a caste dictatorship, eventually the most rigidly stratified society on earth. Now, suddenly, a country made up of the Third World and the First World is a country where the Third World of endless hardship and poverty is in the great majority, and for the first time is entitled to vote. Here, the majority speak different languages than most of the First World minority, has had a different history, and looks different. No other country faces so much change. For at least 50,000 years, people like these were living in South Africa. For that longer time, they had the whole country to themselves. They used no single name for themselves because other people they encountered looked just like them and lived like they lived. We know them by the single name different kinds of newcomers have given them. San, Sarwa, Bushman. Who were their ancestors? 3 1/3 million years ago, there lived in South Africa people whose heads and faces were shaped differently from theirs. But these people also walked like they did. And where did they come from? Our minds tell us that these first hominids in South Africa came from the forest to the north, from ancestors who were four-legged primates. Apes of the African forest are the closest primates to hominids physically. The line of hominids goes back several million years. But the line of forest apes goes back tens of millions of years. Since we branched off physically to begin walking as we do, the ways adults relate to each other as a group also changed. Judging from the behavior of present-day common chimpanzees and gorillas, our common ancestor would have been a member of a group under a chief. The chief alone mated with the females. Any other male who tried to mate with a female was in for an immediate fight. Among common chimpanzees, negotiating alliances with other members of the group and fighting to unseat the chief occupies much of their time. Forest apes face no greater external danger than an attack by another group of apes, like this war party. The great and speedy carnivores did not hunt in the forests. Forest apes could afford to preserve a group life where rank and privilege was the law, and where bad feelings, sooner or later, erupted in violence. The last people to occupy South Africa exclusively lived in bands of a few families. They hunted food and gathered it while, like common chimpanzees do. But there were no chiefs among them, no rank and privilege. They were completely egalitarian, food-sharing people. The change is enormous. What brought it about? Could it be that the hominids who moved over the plains and those who crossed into South Africa were entering the territories of great carnivores, greater than the most powerful four-legged carnivores of today? Saber-toothed tigers they could not outrun. Bears 12 foot tall could see them first. Packs of giant wolves patrolled. Hominids living on these plains needed maximum cooperation by all members. The threat to personal safety was so great that claims to rank and privilege and the accompanying bad feelings would have been intolerable. There were disruptions brought on probably by sexual conflicts reminiscent of ancient behaviors, because they didn't fight over material possessions. But such violence was so uncommon as to be recorded in paint. As one anthropologist who studied a group of their descendants has written, a fight between members is feared like we fear atomic warfare. These were egalitarian societies. Brilliant societies, ample time and incredible opportunities to exercise their imaginations. ...15 hours or so a week it took to supply their material wants. Remembering his childhood, a hunter-gatherer told an interviewer, "Everything I know, I learned from when I was little, when my father and grandfather were still alive. I learned from listening to them every evening when they were together. Around the fire, they talked about the hunt and the gathering of food, and so I started to learn. When they went to the veldt, they took me along, and there in the veldt, I learned even more. The first episode in this series is entirely devoted to hominid hunter-gatherers, but one matter deserves reiteration. There was no poverty among them. The resources available to them most seasons exceeded their wants. No one wanted more than he or she could carry. Poverty occurs only among sedentary people who can accumulate and lose possessions. But South Africa was not paradise. There was the worry of what would become of an aged and infirm grandparent. An economy where everyone had to be on the move to survive. Sometimes it became impossible to continue to carry an infirm person when the necessary journey was not even half over. So there was abandonment, sometimes. There was illness. A woman who gave birth to twins was not condemned for killing one of the newborn. She hoped to smother it before it could take its first breath, a difficult and not always possible task. She knew she would not be able to handle the burden of walking miles under the sun with the weight of two suckling children on her back, still needing suckling to the age of four. Adding for the journey back the weight of the food she had gathered. Other women who had given birth, or expected to, or were too old, could imagine it. They didn't condemn her. According to another anthropologist who lived among them, these people had a sense of living abundant lives. Here, a musician performs to an appreciative audience. But abundant lives did not prevent a bitter future. About 25 centuries ago, hunters or women gathering wild fruits saw a sight that they couldn't have imagined. A group of grazing animals who didn't flee from the men and boys among them. These animals also had never been seen before in South Africa. Fat-tailed sheep and cattle. Their herders called themselves real people, Khoikhoi. To hunter-gatherers, they looked just like ordinary people. The same coppery skin tone, the same hair, just a little taller. When they spoke, it was not always possible for a hunter-gatherer to pick out their meaning immediately, although clicks also ran through the herder's speech. But the herders were different in more ways than that they accompanied strange animals. They didn't bed down in small communities. Their camps, composed of woven or hide huts, could rest 600 people. Also, these people actually milked the strange animals and drank that milk. They bedded them in the middle of their own camp. When asked to explain how they came by these animals, a Khoi man would have had a difficult time answering. To try to convey that he inherited them from his father would just bring up another question. What is inheritance? Herders and hunters tried to stay friendly. But their ways of life and the attitudes growing from these ways were so different. Friendship was possible only for so long. Although animal milk was a rich resource, The koi life was more stressful, and this shaped their behavior and attitudes, both to campmates and to hunter-gatherers. Many more herding families lived together than people in a hunter-gatherer camp, a source of stress. Another was that the koi introduced property ownership to South Africa, and with it came theft. Some koi men possessed more animals than others did. Some men inherited nothing. Such men were the poor men of the camp. Perhaps the man on trial here was one of them, because poor men without property commit most offenses. Certain members of the camp felt impelled to give these poor men a derogatory name, the same name they would come to apply to hunter-gatherers, San, meaning worthless. The koi didn't know that some of their ancestors had also been hunter-gatherers, just like the strangers they now call San. Because now there were rich and poor, and many people living in close proximity, the opportunities for anger and conflict had increased. People looked to someone best able to give help, the head of the family with the most animals and the most family members. This was also a person not to be crossed. The chief couldn't always have his own way, because he had to deal with other cattle-owning families, whose help or forbearance he might need. They too had animals and men who would fight. To hunter-gatherers, everything about the koi, except their physical appearance and the sounds in their speech, was strange. The way they used animals. They circumcised men. Almost everything they did had never been done before in South Africa. Individual koi may have been respectful and courteous to hunter-gatherers, recognizing that they had entered hunter-gatherer lands, but in time a factor beyond human control made friendships impossible. The relationships that developed between the hunter-gatherer owners of the land and the incoming herders was determined ultimately by their different economies. The koi needed good pasturage for their herds and flocks, as well as hunting and collecting opportunities. They rarely slaughtered one of their own animals, unless it was a special occasion, and they didn't grow anything. They were simply herders. The pastures upon which the lives of koi koi depended were the very pastures grazed by the wild animal, upon whose meat the hunter-gatherer families feasted. The same area whose nut trees, fruit bushes, and legumes was now picked and dug up by both hunter-gatherer women and by larger numbers of koi women. Bees' nests with their promise of sweetness were now raided by more people. As the wild resources became ever scarcer, some hunter-gatherer families with little to eat decided to pack it in and go to a koi camp and ask for assistance, if need be, promising in exchange to provide any service required. Some became hunters and gatherers for koi families, sustained by their milk. With the passage of time, children of hunter-gatherer mothers had fathers who were prosperous koi. Their descendants might inherit livestock of their own and speak the language and express the outlook of the koi. But this was only one outcome. Some hunters, having seen none of the usual wild animals, shot one of the new animals, not knowing or not caring that animals could be owned. Koi knew the name and character of each of their animals. Some could whistle their cattle home at night. San came to mean someone worse than a thief. They had to take action. Some hunter-gatherer bands resisted the herders' incursions collectively, but they were no match for much larger bodies of men. How this first clash of cultures affected individual lives is not part of Africa's recorded history. But by the middle of the 17th century, hunter-gatherer communities were to be found only high up in the mountains, and in South Africa's desert interior, where they obtained subsurface water by sipping it through hollow reeds. In the more favored areas, where great-grandparents and ancestors had collected plants and hunted for more than 50,000 years, no hunter-gatherer communities were to be seen. But the Khoi, too, were to come face to face with the unexpected and the unimagined, resulting also in the complete disappearance of their way of life in South Africa. Around 400 AD, people started crossing the Limpopo, but these people looked different from both hunter-gatherers and herders. They were bigger and darker, their languages completely incomprehensible, their movements irresistible. We call them mixed farmers because they had herds and flocks and a milk supply like the Khoi, but they also made farm plots on which they grew most of their food. Among them were specialists who could smelt iron ore and manufacture iron-tip weapons. They introduced the Iron Age to South Africa. Where there were many streams, they settled in individual homesteads. Homesteads more substantial and meant for longer stays than any previously seen in South Africa. But their dwellings, consisting of separate buildings for each adult rather than separate rooms as we have, were parts of cooperating communities, societies that came to number in the thousands and the tens of thousands. Where surface water sources were fewer and far between, they settled closer together. Their chiefs were more powerful than Khoi chiefs. The chiefs' fields were held by their subjects. The chiefs' subjects, rather than the royal family, contributed the cattle that compensated families from whom chiefs took wives for the loss to these families of their daughters' services. But chiefs were not all powerful. In return for their subjects' submission, chiefs were expected to employ their greater wealth for the greater good, helping those who had fallen into need with milk and food and even cattle. Everyone was entitled to state his case before the chief. A stingy or headstrong chief was rarely met with insurrection. Instead, dissatisfied subjects deserted him, emigrating to other chieftaincies, or to the edge of what was then an advancing frontier. A chief without followers, went the proverb, is not a chief. Indeed, his followers were the providers of his wealth. Public opinion ruled. Thus, an especially powerful chief who had, by order, made himself heir to the property of any subject who died without heirs in the direct line, was forced to retract this order. But another order forbidding men who discovered marital infidelity from personally taking revenge against their wife's seducer became established law. Like the Khoi, the mixed farmers consisted of both rich and poor, and there was envy about possessions, tensions unknown to hunter-gatherers. Neighbors might deliberate as strange and unusual the way one person's herd seemed to grow in number when others suffered sickness, or why an outspoken and unpopular woman seemed to have the greenest thumb. The target of a charge of witchcraft could be anyone. People were reluctant to be seen as different, as standing out. Even those who were different and didn't see the world in quite the way they had been schooled to see it. All had received formal schooling. Young males went into the mountains for formal training, their faces painted white as they entered their place of exclusion. White was the color of the death they were to endure, the death of their carefree childhood, prior to their rebirth as adults. Imbued with Ubuntu, humanity. Here one of their teachers would circumcise them to mark the sharpest turning point in their lives. They were taught what the community believed, its history, how sacrifices by ancestors had made the community possible, its faith that the community was guided by God, the reed which had broken pieces off itself to create humankind and all else. They were instructed in what the community expected of a man, including that he be generous and law-abiding, and willing to sacrifice himself personally for the community, as the ancestors had. They danced before their communities, and washed off the color of their childhood's death. Women became adult in a similar way, though without their bodies being cut. With this education, thinking outside of the mainstream, let alone expressing such thoughts, must have been difficult. Such education gave a conservative tone to these communities and chieftaincies. Children were taught and learned to be respectful of those older than themselves, those whose nurturing and protective roles they saw playing out in front of their eyes. Even elder siblings were accorded courtesy. Drawing on community support, the family was strong. Marriages were arranged. The groom's family received the strongest, fittest daughter-in-law they could afford. The bride's family, in compensation for the loss of the services their daughter had provided them, received an agreed number of stock, or mixture of goods. Sometimes a young man could persuade his parents to let him marry a woman of his own choice, a real beauty perhaps, even though this might mean a greater expenditure by his parents. There were occasional stock thefts and wars. These wars between groups of mixed farmers usually lasted less than a day, and would be decided after someone got injured or killed. When combatants faced the question, how many stolen animals were worth an incapacitating injury? Women and children were seldom hurt. An English officer traveling through a still independent chieftaincy in 1809 noted that more than 200 animals had been left overnight in charge of an 8-year-old boy. For centuries, the mixed farming societies of South Africa were successful in having achieved internal order and security. They had met the needs and wants of their expanding populations by displacing herders from most of the rain-watered lands, as well as drier areas with surface water, both originally the exclusive preserves of hunter-gatherers. This map shows what had happened at the moment when three Dutch ships with the first white settlers entered Table Bay at the lower left of the screen. The white dotted line is the key to South Africa's prior history. Land to the right of this line and below it receives more than 20 inches of rainfall annually. Land to the left and above the line, less than 20 inches, diminishing further west to less than 5 inches. Hunter-gatherer communities remained to the right of the line only in the Drakensberg, the Dragon Mountains, which rise parallel to the southeast coast. Others were to be found only in the deserts. No koi herders were left in the best rainfall areas, except in the southwest. In the arid western interior of the country, a few herding communities maintained their flocks along the banks of the Orange River. Mixed farmers held possession of nearly all the good rainfall region, as well as most areas with surface water. Those farmers then occupying the semi-tropical 100-mile-wide corridor between the Drakensberg and the southeast coast spoke minor variations of a single language, generally known by the names of each variation, Xhosa, Zulu, Swazi. Anthropologists are more struck by the singularity of this language, and so refer to it by one name, Nguni. Most of the mixed farmers who had entered South Africa from the north and then spread over the drier high plains also spoke a single language, Sesotho, with variants by which people are known today, Tswana, Pedi, Sotho. Today, these people, together with the Nguni speakers, constitute the great majority of South Africa's people. The three ships heading for anchorage in the bay at the foot of Table Mountain in April 1652, after months of voyaging from Holland, filled with boredom, sickness, and fear, belonged to the Dutch East India Company, the largest trading company then in the world, with 6,000 vessels manned by 48,000 sailors. The mission was to establish a refreshment station, to grow fruits and vegetables, and provide meat for the company's seamen and passengers. This cape should become the halfway stop on the 6 months' journey between Holland and Indonesia. Just a month after Van Riebeck's arrival, a ship came in having thrown 37 bodies overboard, dead from scurvy, its journey to the Indies only halfway over. The company's hospital in the Indies was reported to be, quote, so crowded with invalids who often lie there for months without doing any work, but drawing wages notwithstanding. The 80 men on the three ships were thus formed by a world so very different from the world on which they landed. Theirs was a world which for 10,000 years had been at the end of the main route along which new people and new ideas had travelled most frequently and most easily. Their ancestors had learnt, through intermediaries, about Chinese explosives and firearms, about Hindu numerals, and a god first proclaimed in the Middle East. They came from towns already dependent on global trade, facing people from a land where the winds of change had blown less frequently. Some of the 80 had been shanghaied off the streets of Amsterdam. It was hard to get men to man all the company's ships. Also, though, there were men for whom the company's service in the sea had been their profession. The mission commander, Jan van Riebeck, had previously been dismissed from the company's service for conducting his own business on company time. He was brought back specifically for this mission. They were to maintain peaceful relations with the local people. They were to give copper ornaments to these pastoralists in exchange for cattle and sheep sufficient to supply the fleets and thousands of sailors on long voyages, plus additional animals for breeding. These amounted to more animals than the koi would consent to barter away. Also, employers were to clear good land next to a stream of fresh water and grow vegetables, fruit, and grain. This was a stream the koi used, and the gardens to be laid out was land on which they pastured their sheep and cattle. The koi saw the Dutch building a fort, first of mud, then of stone. The first of three wars between Holland and Britain broke out 3 months after Van Riebeck's party had landed, too recently to allow this news to reach him, but not too early to prepare for anything. The fort was unlike anything seen before by any koi person, but a clear signal that these people were intending to stay. The koi reaction took two forms, one, as the white newcomers saw it, being criminality. A small band who had no cattle or sheep and lived by collecting shellfish along the shore began to fetch wood and water for the newcomers and milk their cows. One day, after they had helped themselves to anything they could lay their hands on in the Dutch camp, knives, tobacco, brass buttons off a few Dutch children's clothes, they made off with some cattle and sheep the newcomers had acquired, after killing the young herd boy. The more prosperous cattle owners saw their lives irrevocably changing for the worse and took up arms, hopeless as this was. After their defeat and punishment, Van Riebeck, reporting to his head office, wrote, "The reasons advanced by them for making war upon us, arising out of the complaints that our people had stolen and eaten some of their sheep and calves, etc., in which there is some truth, and which it is very difficult to keep the common white people from doing when a little out of sight. So they think they had cause for revenge, and especially, they said, upon people who had come to take the land which had been their own in all ages, turning with a plough their best land, and keeping them off the ground on which they had been accustomed to pasture their cattle, so that they must now, consequently, seek their sustenance by pasturing on the land of other people from which nothing could arise but disputes with their neighbors. Insisting so strenuously upon the point of restoring to them their own land, that we were at length compelled to say that they had entirely forfeited that right through the war which they had waged upon us, and that we were not inclined to restore it, as it now had become the property of the company by the sword and the laws of war." The punishment was that Khoi lost their cattle and sheep. First Khoi in the neighborhood of the new European world, then, as the settlement expanded, herders and shepherds further and further away lost their herds and flocks. South Africa, home to slow-paced societies for so long, was becoming part of the mainstream. This fact was underlined by the arrival of smallpox. Without a natural immunity, Khoi survivors buried loved ones. After the burial, what was left for the survivors? No cows and sheep to watch over, no food to cook. Their only option was to become of service to the newcomers. To gratify men who had not had the pleasure of a woman's company for months, bear such a man's children, herd his livestock, join his army, run his errands. Some of their descendants made as good or better adjustments. Some went hunting on their own account. Some became commercial fishermen, sold their fish. Some became self-employed craftsmen and tradespeople. Some learned other lessons from civilization. Wherever they wound up, in the growing settlement of Cape Town, or near it on winter rainfall farms, those Khoi who survived outbreaks of smallpox encountered slaves who were even worse off. The slaves, too, had been brought into the world's mainstream. Some, from Indonesia and elsewhere where the company operated, were Muslim. Some were from Dahomey in West Africa. Some were from Angola. They had been captured on the high seas. All came in speaking their own languages. None were from the zone 300 and more miles to the east where the mixed farmers were still advancing. The first slaves were landed 6 years after Van Riebeck landed. The Angolans captured at sea and the other enslaved people imported subsequently worked the company's fields and gardens, and served its officials. Some were sold to former employees who were discharged and were allotted 30-acre farms to hold in freehold. This had been done by the company as a cost-cutting measure. Their wages were saved, the cost of transporting grain from the Far East to feed them was saved. In fact, they were expected to grow grain and other crops and to sell the surplus to the company at a price the company fixed. Another saving. Also, defense costs could be reduced, as the free men would constitute an unpaid militia. More discharges were given. Even some European immigrants arrived, though not many. Some of the free men set themselves up as townspeople, as tavern keepers, woodcutters, brickmakers, bakers, tailors, wagon makers, and other lines of endeavor. Here, too, slaves were employed. Many slaves tried to escape. Some intended to travel back to their home countries on foot. Others planned to steal a boat. Jan van Riebeek's journal entry of the 10th of October, 1658, shows that the habit of freedom died hard. Same weather, it reads, wind as before. When the gates were opened this morning, a male and female slave of the Honorable Company deserted. They were not recovered today. They are an old and sickly couple who could hardly walk without a stick and always pretended that they were incapable of doing anything, so they are bound to perish. Escapes became rarer as the settlement expanded and generations grew up who had not known freedom. Slave women were employed by the company as prostitutes to augment company income. In town and on the farms, slave mothers-to-be met fathers who were Khoi or West African or Indonesian or European. There were more white men than women in the country for a century and a half. The company brought in orphan girls from Holland. These were few. The company's fleet stopped in Table Bay. More men. A company inspector who visited the Cape in 1671 reported that 3 of every 4 children born of enslaved mothers were of European paternity. The result was the beginning of a new people in South Africa, and a new people in the world, the Cape Colored people. A spectrum of colors and shapes. And diverse traditions, more than any other people, combining village and state traditions of West and East Africa with the outlook of Indonesia and the traditions of Khoi herders and hunter-gatherers. Some remained Muslim. Some became practicing Christians. Their old languages are not spoken anymore. Afrikaans, a language of European origin, is the common language of this new people. The recorded piece of music you are hearing was composed and played by a Cape Colored man, Abdullah Ibrahim. The colored people was born in slavery and servitude. At first, though, all children of European fathers were regarded as being European, entitled to instruction in the Christian religion, to baptism and freedom. This belief carried over from Holland that a Christian could not keep a Christian as his slave, if carried through, would have deprived the company and the freemen of the Cape of all of their slave laborers, who, now having become servants, would be free to leave at any time they saw a greener pasture. To counter this possibility, while not directly blocking the spread of Christianity, the company prohibited sexual intercourse between Europeans and slaves. It also prohibited emancipation of any slave unless the owner guaranteed that the former slave would not become a burden on public welfare funds within 10 years of emancipation. This was aimed at the practice of owners who used emancipation to rid themselves of the responsibility of caring for old or sick slaves. At the same time, the owners had begun not baptizing any slave, young or old. The religious beliefs they had brought to South Africa remained the beliefs of people back home who were living in a different world than they, and faced different sets of choices than they. But the decline in baptisms did disturb the Dutch Reformed Church, the church which followed them to South Africa. Christians were their constituency. To limit the number would be a violation of Christ's injunction to spread the word. The church finally resolved on a two-part solution. Proselytizing must go on. Second, a Christian could keep a Christian as his slave. This was, the church found, God's word. People were adapting to their changed circumstances. Years later, a foreign traveler encountered a landowner, one of whose children was a slave, which he had fathered. Other property owners were encouraging visitors from Europe to sleep with their domestic slaves so as to acquire additional slaves from the offspring without having to pay for them. Two beginnings had occurred. The beginning of a new people was one. It was also a new beginning for South Africa. The country now contained a slave society. For the first time in its history. The colony of masters, servants, and slaves, which enterprising Europeans had established at the green southwestern tip of Africa, expanded from there. This was because soon there were no jobs for white freemen, only the position of master. Slavery and servitude precluded a master's son from making any sort of living except as a master. The opportunity to become an independent master was limited. Cape Town could support just so many taverns and other businesses. As for the beautiful rain-watered farms between the sea and the escarpment, they were taken up by first-comers who were now wealthy men. They had large families. Not much of a future for a younger son. Some colonists wound up in Cape Town destitute on public welfare. South Africa's poor white problem, which is the other side of the coin of non-white slavery and servitude, was beginning. There was one way out. There was land, high and dry, plateau land, beyond the great escarpment. Here, cattle and sheep could negotiate distances on their own legs, as well as handle the difficult passes through the mountains and down the escarpment to market in Cape Town. So the trek boer was born. The trekking pastoralist, often a younger son of a prosperous slave master, without any prospects for his own life but to push on and become a herder, like the koi, a herder with a gun. Koi were now his servants. Life up on the plateau meant separation from all the goings-on in the little breath of Europe that was Cape Town. It meant weeks without seeing another white man. The land was too dry to permit close settlement, and seeing clear to the horizon without seeing the smoke from any other fire was the only possible way to live. Aside from sugar, tea, and a few other amenities to lighten the day, and ammunition obtained from peddlers, he could survive. Beside a gun, the trek boer had a Bible. Was he not like Abraham and his children and his servants and his flocks, a God-fearing nomad among the heathen? From mountains rimming the dry plateau on which Atrekpo's sheep required thousands of acres on which to find their food, hunter-gatherers made their last stand. On the rock surfaces of their mountains, they painted what they saw. They rustled the invaders' animals, shot poisoned arrows into those they could not drive off. This did not deter the Trekboers. For them, there was no going back. Some, with the help of a few neighbors, tried to recover their animals, but they faced an adversary as determined to survive as they were themselves. Some, out of conscience and hope for peaceful coexistence, tried to transform hunters into pastoralists by giving them some sheep. But the land was too harsh and the water points too few to support many flocks. The principal solution was extermination. Trekboers from entire districts organized themselves into commandos. The commandos rode out not in search of individual culprits, but to seek out and kill hunter-gatherers per se. They considered hunter-gatherers who not only robbed them of livestock, but deliberately maimed those they had to leave behind, as vermin, worse than thieves. No quarter was given by either side. Once a killing foray ended, any hunter-gatherer children captured alive were divided among the commando's members to be raised as apprentice servants in the Trekpo household, along with the koi servants. All that is now left of the hunter-gatherers are hundreds of thousands of paintings and engravings scattered throughout a land that had been theirs for untold generations. The hunter-gatherers were a problem Trekboers themselves could overcome. 120 years after Van Riebeck's landing, they encountered a problem that was much more difficult to overcome. The Trekboer frontier, then 300 miles east of Cape Town, came face to face with another frontier, this one moving westward. It was also a successful frontier. Behind it, the number of people and animals kept increasing, pushing it ever westward. The mixed farmers behind this frontier had overcome the same obstacles the Trekboers had. Their solutions were similar. Even outcomes were similar. The original mixed farmers had pushed out the koi and hunted down the hunter-gatherers. Like the Trekboers, they had taken some to be their servants. They had also accepted some koi and hunter-gatherer refugees as servants. One outcome was that words and expressions and names picked up from dealing with servants, some of whom became nannies to their master's children, entered the speech of each invader. Hunter-gatherer and koi cliques helped to shape the speech of the Xhosas, the advance guard of the Nguni mixed farmers. The Xhosa language contains more than 6,000 words of koi and san origin. Likewise, Trekboers incorporated parts of their slaves' and servants' speech in their own changing language. Already, Malay and other slaves had given it their infusions. The language was well on its way to becoming Afrikaans. The Trekboers especially were beginning to see themselves as Afrikaners, a people of Africa, not of Holland, not of Europe. When they weren't living out of a wagon, they slept mostly in mud houses, without ceilings, but with a thatched roof in which there was a hole to let out the smoke from the fire on the floor. A floor, like a Xhosa floor, made of clay and cow dung. A square hole in a wall served as a window. Koi mats separated the beds. The difference was that they had the Bible and the gun. But these differences were disappearing. Soon, Christian evangelists would come among the Xhosa. The Xhosa were already getting guns supplied to them by traders from Cape Town. They were getting horses, and they were a numerous people. One of their chiefs had 10,000 subjects. Here, in the Fish River Valley, the two streams of people collided. For both peoples, pasture and arable land and water sources were necessities. Likewise, additional hunting land was their main source for obtaining meat. Hunting land was also important to both because from the ivory obtained from shooting elephants, traders paid in weapons and ammunition. And for the Xhosa, hunting produced their clothing. The Dutch East India Company, the first multinational corporation in the world and the first company to issue stock, was on its last legs. It would soon go bankrupt. Its governor at the Cape tried to forestall the inevitable. In 1778, he journeyed out from Cape Town to set a row of beacons to mark a line neither side was to cross. War on the frontier would cost the company money, the cattle trade, the ivory trade, even the private weapons trade, all would be disrupted. But the governor lacked means to enforce his beacons. The Trekboers could not handle the Xhosa as they wished. The company was of no help to the Trekboers. Drought made the situation worse, both for them and the Xhosa. Stealing and killing took place while people searched for means to stay alive, including new pastures on both sides of the Fish River. Trekboer families crossed the Fish River looking for pasture in Xhosa lands. Xhosas crossed in the opposite direction for the same reason. The frontier zone was no longer a thin line, but a wide belt of conflict. This situation confronted the British government in 1795 when it dispatched a naval force to take the Cape Colony from the Dutch. A world war was then in progress. Holland had become a satellite of Britain's enemy, Napoleon's France. To forestall any attempt by the French to cut the sea lane from the east on which the British economy depended, the occupation of the Cape Colony was ordered. General Craig, the first British governor, commanded the judicial administration to end the practice of torturing slaves and coy suspected of a crime. But neither he nor his successors solved the insoluble problem of land hunger on the frontier. The British had acquired a colony so poor in prospects that not many people could make a living. At this time, nearly 7 million free men and their slaves lived in the United States. In the Cape Colony, by contrast, there lived close to 14,000 free men and close to 15,000 slaves. A small number, even when counting coy servants and the remaining coy herders and the mixed farmers who had crossed Governor Plettenberg's frontier. Exports were small amounts of wine from the rich manors near Cape Town and small amounts of ivory and wool from the interior. Britain had been compelled to acquire a naval base in a poor colony with a big problem, which was going to produce an unwanted and continuing expense. It was soon compelled to commit its own forces to quell what could turn into a state of general insurrection if it failed to act. It sided with its chief constituency, the white Afrikaner population of its colony, which contributed auxiliary forces. The British also fielded a coy unit under white officers, the Cape Mounted Rifles. Time and again, scenes like this and worse were repeated. Their main effect was to make the Xhosa even more desperate. conferences between British officers and Xhosa leaders failed to calm the frontier. 2 months after this conference, war broke out again. In an attempt to reduce military expenditures and dig itself out of the hole which occupation of the Cape had brought it, the British government enticed 5,000 Britons to sign up for passage to South Africa. It was a way for them to get away from the troubles in Britain, where many had suffered on the long unemployment queues during the economic depression that came after Britain's victory in the Napoleonic Wars. There would be no charge for the boat trip, and a farm and government assistance at the other end. What the settlers weren't told was that their promised 100-acre farms were laid out along a violent border, and that their males could expect combat duty alongside the military. Their dwellings became fortresses. The Xhosa advance was checked and sent into reverse. Thousands of Xhosa cattle were taken by the victors. Without cattle, Xhosas had no milk, their principal food. Independent Xhosa life disappeared, first from the land west of the Fish River, then from lands further and further east. The remaining Xhosa chiefdoms were inundated with refugees. Everyone became more stressed. Chiefdoms fought each other, while the pressure increased from Trek Boers, their British colonist allies, and British troops. Each new war, there were two frontier wars before the British arrived, seven frontier wars after, each worsened the worsening situation of Xhosa mixed farmers, both those still with land and those without. Not only were new refugees coming among them from the west, they were coming from the east at about the same time. They too had been produced by a cataclysm. It struck most dramatically among people further up the coastal corridor between the Umzimkulu River and Mozambique, although it spread down this corridor as well as across the mountains, into the high plains of the interior, and far to the north of South Africa itself. Some believe the cataclysm started when people, including those of the then tiny Zulu chiefdom and its neighbors, got maize plants from Mozambique, brought there from the Americas by the Portuguese. Maize added to the food supply and helped population grow at a faster rate, but at a time when the limits of arable land had been reached. Down the corridor, the Xhosa were retreating, not advancing. On the high plains, Sotho mixed farmers had reached the edge of the Kalahari Desert. Rainfall decreased significantly throughout the region during the first three decades of the 19th century, which began with an exceptionally severe seven-year drought, followed by another not many years later. Pastures dried up, the milk supply was curtailed, and people began to interfere with each other. Previously, the Zulu and other Nguni-speaking peoples of the area had led lives not noticeably different from the Xhosa prior to Xhosa contact with whites. Small mixed farming chieftaincies, a chief constrained by other members of the community who were property owners with cattle, fathers with grown sons who manned a small defense force. There was no specialized military training, and no standing armies or professional officers. Men attended to their animals like these farmers giving medicine to an ox. Women attended to their children, their gardens, and domestic chores. Wars and casualties were few. Non-combatants were not killed. The first breaths of the cataclysm to come was an increase in conflict over access to drought-stricken pastures, within chieftains and in wars between them. It was in this atmosphere that there grew up a young man who, like so many others of his time, never reached old age. He is known to history as Shaka. This is a contemporary drawing, but whether it represents his likeness is unknown. He was born the illegitimate child of the Zulu chief, who disowned him and his mother. She was a resourceful woman. She took him on a series of moves to relatives in other chiefdoms. Nearly everywhere, playmates taunted him about his illegitimacy. In 1802, during a crippling drought, there occurred the famine, given the name by the people who suffered it, Madla Tule, meaning, let each eat what he can and say nothing about it. Shaka was 15. His mother took him to stay with her father's relatives in the Metetwa chiefdom, where conditions were less difficult. Here, a great social change had taken place as warfare intensified. Circumcision of young men was abandoned. All able-bodied men might be needed instantly. No time could be allowed for young initiates to recover fully from the operation. The military system was reorganized. In place of the former territorial units with their chief loyalty to their home neighborhoods, regiments were newly organized of men of approximately the same age, irrespective of what neighborhood they came from. Local leaders were thereby weakened. Their young men were now scattered throughout the army. Regimental loyalty was inculcated through distinctive uniforms and shields. This also made it possible to incorporate conquered groups more securely, as their arms-bearing men could be separated and attached to established Metetwa regiments. But the Metetwa chief, Dingiswayo, carried changes only so far. He allowed defeated chiefdoms to survive, retain their identity, even their ruling families. He was able to place his Metetwas at the head, therefore, of an unstable confederacy, a mistake which would cost him his life, and which Shaka would correct by establishing a unitary state, directed by a single mind. As a resident of Metetwa land, Shaka was enrolled in one of Dingiswayo's new regiments. He distinguished himself, received successive promotions, and so impressed Dingiswayo that when Shaka's father died, he helped Shaka become chief of the small Zulu component of his confederacy. Shaka had the legitimate heir, the oldest of his half-brothers, assassinated. His other half-brothers he let live. One day, one of them would kill him. Now in command of, at first, a mere 500 men, he was free to train them for the kind of war which he believed the times demanded, not the kind of war the older and more conservative Metetwa officers expected to fight. Enemies must be annihilated, not just defeated. No more tactical reliance on a thrown spear, which the enemy could deflect with his shield. A war of annihilation required the short assegai, the stabbing spear. He had his 500 men, divided into three regiments based on age, trained to charge the enemy, deflect the enemy's shield with their own, and thrust in the assegai. The charge itself was orchestrated. For added speed, Zulu soldiers were trained to race without sandals over broken ground. This is not the sound of drums. It is the sound of barefoot Zulus stamping the earth. They were drilled to keep formation while closing on the enemy, the wingtips of their line moving faster than the units near at the center. The enemy would be enveloped, unable to retreat. 51 years later, when the Zulus were governed by a nephew of Shaka, The central column of a British invading force was enveloped and annihilated. The British lost 1,600 men. The list goes on for several pages. Training was constant. Men were not released from service after an active duty, as they had been under the Giswayo. They were expected to serve until about 40 years of age. They were housed in permanent barracks with a women's section stockaded off from the men's. Each barracks a smaller copy of Shaka's own residence. New barracks were built when Zulu territory expanded outward after the death of the Giswayo. Soldiers fed off the milk and meat of captured cattle. Unable to help out at home, neither did they present their parents and grandparents with extra mouths to feed. Marriage would interfere with the intensity and focus of training. Perhaps it would weaken the willingness of a soldier to put his life on the line. It was prohibited to those on active service, except to older men already married, who formed the reserve, directly behind the chest of the Zulu battle formation between the two horns. Shaka himself did not marry. Sexual play was permitted to his male and female soldiers, but not intercourse for conception. The military transformation for close combat with the Asakai, which multiplied even Zulu combat deaths and wounds to an unprecedented number, and the restriction of marriage and procreation, the most fundamental right of Zulus, testifies to the uniqueness of the times. No Zulu would have accepted the risk of close combat and the restriction of marriage at any other time. But how did the Zulus come to be the first to recognize the trend into which they, along with all the people of the region, had been cast? Their lives were not noticeably different from these other people. It was because Shaka was installed among them, and he was different. He was a child rejected by his father, a status and a condition uncommon in his society. His perspective was different, less tied to convention. The well-adjusted, still prosperous conservatives didn't see that trouble was coming. Perhaps because they didn't want to. Shaka's installation as their chief after he had been a participant in his half-brother's murder was what woke them up. It took 3 years for Shaka to extend Zulu authority over an area of 20,000 square miles, 200 times larger than his little chiefdom had been in 1816. He had gained both assent and acquiescence from enough Zulu elders to transform the society. When his old mentor, Dingiswayo, after defeat in battle, was put to death by the chief of the rival Ndwandwe Confederacy, the Zulu force was ready. First, the remnants of the Metetwa Confederacy were taken over, their civil authorities abolished, and the young men allotted to Zulu regiments. To halt these developments, the Ndwandwe army marched into Zululand. It was repulsed by the outnumbered Zulus, but the Zulus suffered many casualties. A European trader who observed the battle noted that the number of Zulus killed and wounded was almost half the number of their original force. Zulu dead outnumbered Zulu wounded by 3-1. Another much larger Ndwandwe force invaded Zululand in 1819. But all foodstuffs had been removed from the path of its advance. Its quartermaster unit was ambushed and its supplies seized. The main force was not attacked by the shadowing Zulu force until it was retreating, tired and hungry, and halfway across the Malatuzi River. The half that hadn't yet crossed didn't outnumber the Zulu force that was waiting for the order to attack. The Zulu victory at the Malatuzi River made the Zulus, their ways, their Nguni dialect, supreme throughout northern Nguni land. But the battle also had repercussions far beyond South Africa. One of the defeated, escaping commanders who had witnessed the effect of Zulu weapons and tactics at that battle and trained other survivors to use them, crossed the Limpopo River and entered the territory of an ancient gold mining and trading empire. His forces created a modern tourist site by leaving in ruins the seat of that empire, from whose name the present state of Zimbabwe takes its name. Another of the participants in the Battle of the Malatuzi River, one of Shaka's own commanders, who subsequently broke with him, led another Nguni force over the Drakensberg Mountains and eventually also into Zimbabwe to impose themselves as a ruling class on the local Shona-speaking people. Today, descendants of these invaders have become one of the chief objects of repression by Zimbabwe's government. Their businesses and homes have been demolished. Thousands have cut through the border fence to become illegal aliens in Botswana and South Africa, desperate for employment and desperate to avoid deportation back to Zimbabwe. News media have given their plight worldwide attention. Beyond Zimbabwe, Nguni forces carried their language and ways into Malawi and into Tanzania. These Tanzanian villages today are among their descendants. The disaster flowing from land hunger and drought that was unfolding before the Battle of the Malatuzi River and growing in dimension after it is remembered with names that are but its faint echoes. Sutu, as shown here being used as baggage carriers by Nguni troops, remember it as the Difikani, the forced migration, perhaps because there were survivors who sought refuge by migrating into the mountains. Nguni speakers speak of it as the Mfecane, the hammering or crushing. One survivor remembered seeing a child who had died of hunger being eaten by another child. It was the end of organized community life throughout large regions of eastern South Africa. Survivors of thousands of catastrophes fled. Effectively protected from invasion, Zululand, now greatly expanded with 15 military barracks situated throughout the territory, was the eye of the hurricane. There was meat, there was milk, but it was not a happy place. The Zulus paid a heavy price for security. As far as Shaka was concerned, the heavy casualties Zulus had suffered were a smaller price to pay than the price they would have had to pay had they lost. Everything else had to be and was linked to this: the intense training, the state's control of marriage, the assignment of a special officer whose mission was to catch cowards, stragglers, and defectors and kill them, a policy adopted by the Soviet government in 1941 when German forces were approaching Moscow. But families of soldiers caught and killed by the Zulu rear guard, and those whose fit men had died on a battlefield, and active duty soldiers chafing at the long wait to start a family, did not see things the single-minded way Shaka did. He, on his part, could not let dissension build. Old men who remembered the old ways were a source of potential or actual danger. One of his military barracks was named Gibitzegu, meaning finish the old men. Whether in commemoration of a purge or for some other reason is unknown. Similarly unknown is the reason his chief residence was named Bulawayo, meaning place of slaughter. English traders reported that civilians were killed for no apparent reason, so that those with reason would not utter a sound. The way in which ecological disaster may lead to a state policy of terror is suggested by events in 1827, when Nandi, Shaka's mother, died. One story told about what then happened was that 60,000 people gathered at Nandi's residence. Several men were executed on Shaka's orders for not appearing sufficiently grief-stricken. This led to a general stampede in the crowd to demonstrate their sorrow. Those who ran out of tears, or those who put spittle into their eyes, or attempted to reach a nearby stream to replenish their body's supply of fluid, were beaten to death by their neighbors as a sign of loyalty to the leader. Shaka eventually put a stop to the carnage, but as a mark of mourning, ordered that for 1 year, women were not to cultivate the soil, nor milk their cows, nor must men impregnate their wives. The prohibitions on cultivation and milking were eventually lifted, but the ban on sexual intercourse remained in effect for the entire mourning period. Shaka had to keep the army constantly employed, not sitting in their barracks idly, muttering to each other. Regiments were dispatched to scour distant countrysides for cattle to seize, bring back and eat. In 1828, the year that he was murdered, Shaka sent the forces southwest into Xhosa territory. They brought back 30,000 cattle taken from the people there. Immediately upon their return, he ordered them out again, this time to the northeast, to attack into Mozambique, where former Ndwandwe soldiers had set up an Nguni state. This long march through malarial country left many soldiers exhausted and ill. In Mozambique, they encountered an enemy now schooled in their own fighting methods. They were repulsed with casualties and retreated in disorder. It was their first defeat. They knew what to expect from Shaka. Two of his half-brothers, princes of the realm, detached themselves from the army, traveled to a small residence where Shaka was then staying, and with the cooperation of Shaka's chief advisor, left Shaka stabbed to death. Zulus could not know an unintended consequence of their search for security. The devastation surrounding them, which many of them had helped to create, would open a path to their own destruction as a state. Further down the corridor where the Xhosa were encountering an advancing white frontier, the cataclysm was growing. Thousands of refugees, their animals seized, their homes destroyed, were coming among them from both directions. What were their hosts to do with these famished and bereft strangers whose numbers kept increasing? Every day they saw threats to their very lives. Threats from refugees for whom there was so little to spare. Threats from the news from the approaching frontier. Despair grew. Some sought refuge by attending Christian churches. Some were being helped and schooled by missionaries. Others saw Christianity as no solution, as the situation only kept getting worse. How effective could this God be? Some couldn't believe the God of the Christians, who had taken their land, wished them well. Some refugees, those from Zulu devastation, who resented being treated badly by the Xhosa among whom they tried to settle, joined the British Army and were prepared to fight every Xhosa. Those who saw no choice threw themselves into the lap of their gods and the old spirits. Some became prophets, seeing and preaching a different future than the future they feared. They taught that first, people must rid themselves of evil within, of ill intention, which had caused others to suffer. They must make sacrifice to the gods. Sacrifice would be the sign they had cleansed themselves. One prophet, like Joshua of ancient Israel, led an attack on a British frontier town, was captured and imprisoned on Robben Island, where Nelson Mandela and others would be imprisoned during the next century. The prophet's return was long awaited in Xhosa country. He drowned, trying to escape from Robben Island. Lung disease of foreign origin began to infect their cattle. They had not cleansed themselves sufficiently, not sacrificed sufficiently. They must sacrifice more. They must sacrifice all of their dun and cream-colored cattle. If they made this sacrifice, the prophet foresaw, on the eighth day following, the dead would rise. For the dead to rise meant that the people had cleansed themselves, and so had put an end to death. But death did not end, even though the designated cattle had been sacrificed. They were at their wits' end. They had not sacrificed enough. One day, the 16-year-old niece of the spiritual advisor to the senior Xhosa chief, Sirili, told her uncle that she and her little companion had gone to scare away birds from the fields. Two men appeared. The horns of beautiful cattle were peeping through the rushes. The men said they had died long ago. They urged the girls to tell the people to kill all their cattle and cease plowing their fields, because their cattle and grains were raised by people who had not cast all evil out of themselves. They must build new cattle byres and dig new grain storage pits to receive the beautiful cattle and grain overflowing the grain pits once they had cleansed themselves of every ill intention and truly sacrificed. All whites would be swept into the sea. The chief's advisor went to the fields to the spot where the girls had seen the dead men. He encountered three dead men, one of whom was his brother. They repeated what they had said to his niece. He then went to tell the chief. Sirili was skeptical at first, but not deeply skeptical. God, through the spirit of the ancestors, had given all, he together with the people, a message. He became convinced and told his followers that he believed the message from the ancestors was true. His subordinate chief, Sandili, was deeply skeptical and said so. Sandili's own mother berated him for his lack of faith and his lack of generosity. "It's all very well for you, Sandili, to turn away from this opportunity. You have reason to live. You have a wife and children. I have nothing. I am all alone. I long to see my husband, who has been dead for so long. I long to be reborn a young, healthy woman. And you, my son, will not follow the prophecy?" Not only was one of the leading families of the Xhosa split, The people, believers and non-believers alike, were at loggerheads with each other. And the non-believers were at loggerheads with the paramount chief for promoting what they saw as a dangerous stupidity. The prophecy had set a date when, provided the people had followed its two requirements, the sun would rise, but it would be a blood-red sun. While waiting for the day, believers killed their animals, set fire to their crops, and prayed. The British estimated that close to 400,000 cows were slaughtered. Starvation might be next if it were not for the approaching day when the sun would rise, blood red. There are continuing disputes today about who was really to blame for the horror that followed. Cyrilli for inflaming the people for a nefarious purpose of his own? Or the British as instigators of the prophecy, as their way of getting rid of people whose land they wanted? A malignant nature which for no known reason keeps proffering and then withdrawing its breast? Or an indifferent or malignant creator who created too many causa for them to enjoy a decent life are not blamed. People gathered on the day the 16-year-old girl had named as the day the sun would rise blood red. Afterwards, believers blamed the non-believers who hadn't killed their animals for causing the prophecy to remain unfulfilled. Many went to steal the animals of non-believers. In the Xhosa frontier zone, starvation was the next result of the blind processes at work. 2/3 of the Xhosa frontier population disappeared from the area. It was estimated at the time that 1 in 5 of the inhabitants died. Some crossed the advancing colonial frontier to seek work in the frontier towns and on the farms on what once had been Xhosa land. Men who had once defended their way of life became household, town, and farm servants, and parents of farm servants. Some became prisoners, and some survived. Nkwawuze, the 16-year-old who had announced the prophecy, was arrested by the British and imprisoned on Robben Island. After her release, she went to a white settler's farm and lived there as a farm servant into old age. Unlike other countries, South Africa has no national monument as yet. The largest monument in the country is the Voortrekker Monument. Standing on a hilltop overlooking Pretoria, South Africa's capital, it represents only one of its peoples, the Afrikaners. It memorializes the energy and courage of their ancestors and their suffering. It commemorates the central epic of their history, the Great Trek, including incidents such as the one depicted on this tapestry, when 40 Afrikaner men, 56 women, 185 children, and more than 200 of their colored servants were killed by Zulus at a place where a small village later grew up named Vianen, meaning weeping. Why did they leave the Cape Colony for even more dangers than they faced in their frontier zone homes? Many of them had lost cattle and sheep. Some had lost their lives in almost continuous fighting with causes, desperately struggling against being driven out of land and livelihood. From white missionaries and traders, the Voortrekkers, as they are called, or pioneers, knew they were headed into regions patrolled by disciplined and powerful African militaries. They left because they felt that in the colony they lived under a foreign occupation. English had been made the official language, although only a minority spoke it. British administrators, missionaries, and settlers. In so many ways, these foreigners were making it harder and harder for them to make a living. They didn't seem to understand how necessary coy or colored farm labor was to them. Without it, farming was out of the question. Few Trek Boer families had any capital saved. Most had virtually no cash. Without koi herders to attend to the cows and sheep, which were often out of the farmer's sight, without colored women in the kitchen to help the Trek Boer's wife with the 1,001 tasks involved with the care of all the men and children, there would be nothing. Foreigners were writing laws, making it easier for the colored help to leave. Coloreds didn't need a pass anymore to leave. Legal equality between white and non-white was ordered. Colored help could make charges in the courts, and that could now lead to an arrest by a posse of mounted coloreds led by a white officer. The British government had no concern for the effect of this on the Trek Boer's authority on his farm. He was no longer permitted to require 10 years of labor service from a colored child, born and brought up on and supported by the farm, free to play and eat up to the age of 8. The British government, in comfortable quarters in London, seemed to think he could afford welfare. I didn't think how much easier this made it for field hands to look for other employment, knowing they were entitled to take their children with them. Foreign missionaries were opening up places that were attracting their servants. Mission stations were teaching koi how to become self-supporting. More and more pressure was coming from foreigners. Not from the 1820 settlers, they had settled into the country. It was coming from missionaries who were not planning to stay in the country. And it was coming from 6,000 miles away in another country. The Trek Boer knew the British to be the greatest of all slave trading nations. He wondered why they had suddenly started hanging people for slave trading. In 1833, they ordered all slaves be freed everywhere where they had control. In Cape Town, slaves paraded when they learned of their freedom. If you wanted compensation for your property being taken away by the government, you could collect compensation only by traveling to London, a large expense in itself, and then the compensation was less than the value of the slave. The British were industrializing, and everything they did was honed by economics, abolition, and equally the small payout to former slave owners. The Trek Boer didn't know this. He was far removed from the Industrial Revolution taking place in England then, far removed from smoke-filled air above ground and child pit boys coughing their youths away deep underground. But he could sense hypocrisy. The last straw was when London ordered that land captured from the Xhosa during the Sixth Frontier War be given back to them. 100 Trek Boers and their servants had been killed in the fighting and raiding, more than 400 frontier farms burned, their animals driven off. Even many of the sheep, goats and cattle retaken and taken from the Xhosa had been eaten by British troops and auxiliaries, and those that weren't eaten were put up for auction. The Trek Boer didn't know that the decision makers in Britain's capital had decided that returning this large area of land would be more cost-effective than opening the area to white settlement. Opening 100 miles of Xhosa land to white settlement would guarantee a seventh frontier war, another war, another extraordinary expense. But the Trek boys had been counting on this land for their sons. What would become of them? All other good pastures were taken up. It was time to leave. About a tenth of the colony's white population left, together with a great number of their colored servants. Not all at once. Over the course of a few years, small and large groups. Some left because their farms were burnt, their animals gone, their pockets empty. Some relished the adventure. Some left because their friends were leaving. They crossed the Orange River. They were out of the British colony. They would set up their own government, make their own rules. They found fertile, apparently uninhabited land on the high plains along both banks of the Fall River, unaware of the function this land served, or had served. Only recently it had been the home of Sotho-speaking mixed farmers. But the cataclysm brought on by land hunger and drought, which had destroyed peace and security among the Nguni-speaking people of the coastal corridor and militarized them, had crossed the mountains. Hungry, armed Nguni raiders had fallen upon the Sotho villages, seized their cattle and grain. The land was apparently uninhabited because many of the inhabitants were dead, or had fled, or had been absorbed into the raiding parties as baggage carriers, which meant that at least they were fed. One of the raiding parties was led by a man formerly a lieutenant of Shaka's, who defied a direct order from Shaka. This was Mzilikazi. The party which had trekked out of Zululand with him originally included only a small number of men and some women. But by using Zulu methods, he had absorbed many men from the diverse communities he devastated, dividing them among regiments based on age, not ethnicity. By the time the four trekkers arrived at the Fall River, he was master of the region. The uninhabited zone they had entered, stripped of grain and livestock, was a buffer meant to discourage the Zulu army from coming after him. Mzilikazi was under no illusion about what was signified by the arrival of white people, with herds of cattle and goats and flocks of sheep. They meant to stay. He was receiving intelligence from many sources, including missionaries and traders. He knew what was happening in the Cape Colony to the Xhosa. He sent a force of 5,000 men against the four trekker encampment at this hill, subsequently named Vechkop, Battle Hill. The Nguni forces were unable to penetrate the four trekker lager, but they succeeded in capturing the four trekker sheep and cattle. Without livestock, including oxen needed to pull their wagons, the four trekkers were in a bad way. Help was sought from the chief of a Sotho-speaking people who had been victimized themselves by Nguni raiders. The chief sent men and oxen to the lager to draw the wagons to his people's mountain refuge. Maroka was his name. He and his people gave the four trekkers food and asylum. When four trekker reinforcements arrived from the Cape, a strong mounted force set out for Mzilikazi's stronghold. The horse was new to the Matabele, as Sotho-speaking people called Mzilikazi's subjects. The horse was combined with a rifle. All the lost cattle and sheep were recovered, and more. Imsilikazi and the Matabele were driven over the Limpopo into what is now the country of Zimbabwe. They fought their way into control of a large part of that country and established a capital, named like Chaka's capital had been, Bulawayo, place of slaughter. The Shona-speaking people of the area became second-class citizens. But it was not these events of the Great Trek that became, thereafter, a national holiday in white-ruled 20th century South Africa. It was the Battle of Blood River. This came about from an additional direction the trek took. Not only north over the plains beyond the Orange River, but also southeastward over the mountains towards land reported to be fertile and uninhabited, with a port, Port Natal, now the city of Durban, then a small settlement of white traders and missionaries, and a place where ammunition and other supplies could be imported. This strangely uninhabited land was adjacent to the Zulu kingdom. While some voortrekkers were establishing themselves on the plains, to the disappointment of Sotho refugees, who with Imsilikazi and his regiments gone, returned to their old farms to find new, powerfully armed strangers in possession. The main body of voortrekkers decided to head for the mountains and the promise of fresh green land. They climbed the Drakensberg, gazed over the land they called Natal. The man they recognized as their leader, Piet Retief, well known as a commando leader on the Xhosa frontier, believed that to avoid misunderstandings, it was advisable to speak to Dingaan, now the Zulu king. It will be recalled that Dingaan was Shaka's half-brother and, for reasons incompletely known, his assassin. With a party of men, Retief went to Mgungundlovu, the place of the great elephant, the Zulu capital. Dingaan was under enormous pressure. The land the voortrekkers wanted was his kingdom's buffer zone. It had been emptied of cattle and people for a reason. If he allowed the voortrekkers or anyone else to occupy it, what security would the kingdom have? He knew how powerful the voortrekkers were. His advisors had informed him of what they had done to Imsilikazi. To oppose their entry would be an enormous gamble. To let them in would be an equal gamble. He struggled with the problem. When Retief arrived with men to negotiate, Dingaan was still in a quandary. To play for time, he told Retief he was, quote, almost inclined, unquote, to grant the voortrekkers land in Natal. But first, as a token of voortrekker goodwill, he would require Retief to recover some cattle a certain Sotho chief had stolen from him. Retief agreed to this condition, and believing the cattle would be recovered without difficulty, sent a message to the voortrekkers waiting on the Drakensberg that the prospects looked good. Upon receiving this, the entire trek began to descend the passes and to spread out over the foothills, but Dingaan had not given his final word. Retief had little trouble recovering the cattle, and with 71 voortrekker volunteers and 30 colored servants, drove the cattle to Mgungundlovu, ready to hand them over to Dingaan in exchange for the title deed to the promised land. But he refused to also accede to Dingaan's additional request for the guns and horses Retief had also taken from the Sotho chief. Guns and horses were the two items Dingaan had requested again and again from the Port Natal traders, two items that were the most difficult to obtain from them. How could men who didn't trust him be trusted? They had driven Imsilikazi over the Limpopo. They had tricked a Sotho chief into surrender. They had begun to take possession of his kingdom's buffer zone before he had given final permission. There was no good option, but his advisors would not allow him to waver any longer. He decided to stake all on eliminating the four trekkers. Retief and his escort were to be seized at the palace. They were to be taken to the hill of execution nearby and clubbed to death. Both scenes were witnessed by the missionary Francis Owen. The main body of four trekkers were to be struck down where they had settled in Upper Natal before they had time to concentrate for defense. The tapestry in the four trekker monument representing the last moments of the people at one of these encampments testifies to the success of this part of Dingaan's plan. One offensive penetration into the kingdom by disaffected Zulus who had fled from the kingdom for the protection of Port Natal, along with the colored and white residents there, was repulsed by Zulu forces, who then went on to burn the settlement and force the survivors to take refuge on a ship that happened to be in the harbor. Another four-trekker penetration was ambushed by regiments under one of Dingaan's commanders. The pain endured was remembered throughout the 20th century. It took several months before help was organized from the Afrikaner community in the Cape, help that included three cannon. We see here a memorial reconstruction of the battlefield at the spot where the battle occurred. This is the site. A small river runs beside it. It used to be called the Nkoma River. The battle added another name, Blood River. People on both sides said their goodbyes. A deep ravine runs down one side, the river on another. The four trekkers had chosen the site for their maximum advantage. The Afrikaners had come organized, able to live off the cattle of the land, disciplined by a new leader, Andries Pretorius, from whom the country's capital is named. Their wagons lashed together, their mounts ready inside the laager, they waited. Their hide shields gave Zulus no protection. Their javelins caused not a single fatality. The horror they faced is captured here. We do not know whether many Zulus understood what they would be up against. It is said that a Zulu addressed his fellow soldiers as follows. If we go forward, we die. If we go backward, we die. Let us go forward and die. The four trekkers counted 3,000 Zulu bodies after the battle was over. No prisoners were taken. This is why the name became Blood River. The inscription reads, The Victory, 16th December 1838. The date was made a national holiday in 1910. It was called by whites Dingaan's Day. On the 100th anniversary of the battle, large crowds gathered in Pretoria to dedicate the country's largest monument. No one there expected that, beginning December 16th, 1995, the name of the national holiday would be changed from Dingaan's Day to the Day of Reconciliation. The four trekkers were not permitted to keep Natal. Just a few years after Blood River, Britain sent Marines into Natal. Four trekker activities there had added to the refugees coming down the coastal corridor, further inflaming a frontier zone that was already consuming British lives and treasure. These old Afrikaners had been four trekkers, 64 years earlier as children. They may have been among the children who left Natal as earlier they had left the Cape Colony. They trekked again, back over the mountains. Parents and caregivers were determined on one more try to live life free of British interference. On the high plains, between the Orange and Vaal rivers, and beyond the Vaal in the Transvaal, they established two independent republics. But as we shall see in part two, this independence lasted less than 50 years. The Zulu Kingdom survived in a diminished form until 1879, when it was presented with an ultimatum by Britain that the leadership and populace judged unacceptable. We have seen picture lists of British casualties from the battle at Isandlwana. Zulus once more were willing to stake all on resisting invasion, even though Blood River had taught them about the effect of concentrated firepower. The Zulu king was led into captivity, but the militant spirit of the Zulu people lived into the 20th century. 120 years after the Battle of Isandlwana, they erected at the battle site this memorial to their fallen regiments. It represents the Zulu Necklace of Valor. The centerpiece is in the form of 5 lion's claws. Visible on the extreme right are 2 sculpted headrests. The headrests remind us of the Udibi, the boys who carried the army's supplies, including the officers' headrests. Boys who were being educated. One by one, the chieftains and kingdoms of African mixed farmers disappeared, as had the Khoi pastoralists, and the hunter-gatherer bands before them. As the 20th century approached, the many systems of authority the country had once known had been reduced to 2. In the interior, Afrikaners ruled. On the seaboard side, it was the British who managed the lives of peoples who had recently managed their own. Throughout South Africa, people with different histories, different languages, different beliefs, lived in the same household as master and servant. Dandi singe ebongweni. Davange zwi elimandi. La choka situ kutezi. Wankiloza kelomfazi. Echongezwi elimandi.
Oh! Hallelujah. Oh.